Blog Talk Radio.
With Barbara Streisand running it out of Cleveland, Ohio. It's American Sports History Podcast, hosted by a brother, a mentor, and a friend, Peter Ray. Yours truly, Mark Mancini, producing in Los Angeles, 347-205-9631. If you happen to miss it, because 30 minutes goes by quick, get your buddies and everybody. Listen on blogtalkradio.com/Mancini Sports Podcast platforms, wherever you subscribe to podcasts, powered now by Mancini Media. So, without further ado, it's more of him, less of me. Let me lay that red carpet, put the podium in its place, hand off the mic, and it's the threes, Peter. How are you? How can people get a hold of you? And your partner in crime here, every 2 weeks, him and you tear up this place. And, boy, it brings an onslaught of listeners, and I'll be happy to run the board, pass them on to you, and sit back and enjoy it, my friend.
Hi, Mark. I'm doing well. I have a YouTube channel. It's my name, Peter J. REA. We make history videos. You're absolutely right. Tonight's guest, for the 15th time, he played Major League Baseball from 1971 to 1981 with the Chicago Cubs, Oakland A's, L.A. Dodgers, San Francisco Giants, and San Diego Padres in spring training. He won two World Series in 1973 and 1974, 395 career stolen bases, two-time American League stolen base leader 1974 and 1976, first Oakland A's designated hitter. He won a National League title in 1978 with the Dodgers, three times led the American League in total chances per game, twice in putouts, once in assists from the outfield on a double play. He's the he was the starting center fielder and the leadoff hitter for the coolest MLB team of all time, the Oakland A's from the early 1970s. Welcome to the show, my good friend Bill North.
Hey, Peter, how are you?
I'm fine. Yeah, it's this show is Bob Gibson and Tim McCarver and Muhammad Ali and Howard Cosella, Thrilla in Seattle and Cleveland. You had this past Saturday, you had Billy Williams on the show. What a wonderful show on your show, Billy Williams.
Yeah, that's, like I said, that's my mentor. And I grew up following him, you know, like a puppy dog. So, yeah, and just a wonderful person and an accomplished man and just a class act is what he is. Yeah.
Yeah, you've got an incredible show. Dusty Baker, Warren Brewster, Gene Tennis, Joe Rudy, Willie Horton, Deshaun Goldson, Steve Garvey, Ferguson Jenkins, Billy Williams, talking about getting Herb Washington coming up next week. And, oh, it's amazing. These baseball cards are coming to life for guys like me. And I'm awful sorry you lost Sal Bando this recently.
Yeah, I did. He was just to meet somebody like him in that, especially in that professional setting that we were in. And he was a true leader. And of that club, and he was the glue, you know, and tough man, good man, yeah. And it was a joy to play with him, and I'm sorry that that he's gone, and I wish his family security and be able to weather this storm.
Yeah, that's why it's so important that you're doing these shows, because you're talking to these guys who are getting older, and for older guys like me, it's nice to, these are our boyhood boys of summer, the guys who are imprinted in our memory, very powerful memories, and I'm so sorry, but so it's good, really good you're doing it with these other guys. Let's see, we got Victor from Coral Gables, Florida. Hi, fellas, really enjoy this show. Keep up the great work. Long live the Oakland Athletics.
Hey, my kind of guy, Victor.
I'd like to continue with your memories from the best, the top 1,000 players from the MLB 1970s. What are your memories about Ron Guidry?
Ooh, Louisiana Lightning. He could pitch. He stayed down. He stayed down, and he was one of those guys that used that. He threw hard. The ball would tail away from a right-hander. But it was that back foot slider. They didn't call it that. It was called the down and in slider in those days. But that was his strikeout pitch. And he was he battled. He come to fight and had a lot of guts. You know, just a little guy, too. He wasn't very big, but he gave it all he had. Yeah. And it wasn't a traipse in the daisies. You can bet that facing it.
Oh, by the way, I don't know if you saw. Did you know they've had the Oakland A's had their new inductees to their Hall of Fame? You were not on the ballot, and I just hope that you're on next year. Kearney Lansford, Gene Tennis got in. Bob Johnson, guy from the '30s. Roy Steele, he was a PA guy. Jason Giambi. Anyway, so yeah, Gene Tennis got in, huh?
He was the announcer. He had one.
Right.
He said, now batting number four, Billy North. And then he'd say, Billy North, number four, Billy North.
Okay. Well, boy, I tell you, they better get you on the ballot next year. And if they do, there's going to be a lot of voting early and often coming from out of Cleveland. Okay, another player from the '70s, Joe Torre.
Gosh, I came up, and he and Billy Williams, I think it was '72, they were fighting for the batting title. It was a year that Billy hit .333 or something like that. Billy won, I think. But Joe Torre could hit. He couldn't. He was pure hitter because he couldn't run for nothing, but I remember in that St. Louis uniform, and he could hit. He was real strong up top, and he sprayed the ball everywhere, and he gets you deep too. Wonderful hitter. Yeah, nice man too.
Yeah, it's funny. He became famous, you know, winning 4 World Series in 5 years with the Yankees. But people maybe aren't aware that he did have a tremendous playing career, Joe Torre.
Yeah, he did. Yeah, and he had a brother, Frank. Yeah.
Okay. Kearney from Lake Havasu. Hi, Peter and Bill. Toughest bunters. And this is his opinion. Rod Carew, Brett Butler, Mickey Rivers. What are your the best bunters that you knew during your career?
Well, those are three good ones right there.
Were you a good bunter, Bill?
Yeah.
You had to be. I mean, you're a fast guy. Yeah, that must have been a part of your repertoire.
Well, and it brings that third baseman in. And then you can work that 5-6 hole, you know, and be able to slap it by him sometimes. But, yeah, I blame it. Oh, yeah. And the more in spring training, in my good years, I'd go down there after every game or after I was out and take 75 bunts. I used to be able to bunt with the nose of the bat.
Would you bunt down to third base or first baseline?
I would drag it every now and then, but mostly third base. And it was, you know, Carew was an excellent bunter. And there were some other guys, too, but Carew was the standard. And what I learned from him about bunting is you have to make a smooth move, okay? And you don't have to move your feet. You just kind of settle in and keep the bat head above the ball. Yeah. But he was real smooth. It was just one smooth action into bunting position. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so when you bunted down the first baseline, would you run on the inside to kind of interfere with the throw without getting called for interference?
Hopefully the throw is coming from the second baseman. I try to drag it by him.
Uh-huh.
But I didn't leave it along the first baseline too much where the catcher can pop out and get it. And or the pitcher can just come over and make the throw. You can't outrun that baseball, so you try to get it by him. But it gets everybody moving, so they lose a lot of spaces out there. I wish I had bunted more.
Did you have a guy who hit you or threw inside, and then you bunted to try to take out the pitcher like Lenny Randle did against Cleveland in, I think, 74?
That happened a few times.
Yeah.
I wanted to hit if he was throwing at me, first off, we'd probably have a conversation, because one time in my career I went one pitch too long and got hit in the head when somebody was throwing at me. That was in the minor leagues. And I was making $700 a month, and we were playing in Waterloo, Iowa, a guy named Doug Bird.
Doug Bird.
Yeah, and then I waited for him to come to the big leagues, and when he came up with Kansas City. And the first time I saw it, I threw my bat towards shortstop and went straight to the mound, and we had a little dance.
So that's when you were you were having an at bat.
I saw him warming up in the bullpen. When Kansas City was coming to town, I started rubbing my hands. And then when he got up in the bullpen, and I went in. When I came in, they brought him in the game. When I came into the dugout, somebody had to get on base for me to get up. And I told Darryl Knowles, I remember vividly, I said, if I get up to the plate, watch this.
Did he throw a pitch?
Shortstop, and I went straight towards the mound.
did he throw a pitch?
He threw a slider. But when I was walking out to the mound, I said, I remember you.
Oh.
He said, that pitch wasn't even close to you. He remembered me, too.
Uh-huh.
And I said, I remember you from Waterloo, Iowa, and he opened his mouth to say something, but it was too late.
Did you work things out with Doug Bird? Was that the end of your conflict?
Well, he kind of would hang around me a little bit, but I don't think he really wanted to do anything, because that didn't end up very well for him. Yeah.
Okay, another great player from the 70s, Lou Brock.
Oh, yeah, he's a man. He was a man. That's another one the Cubs gave away a lot of stolen bases. they traded him to St. Louis. But Brock was a hell of a player. Yeah, there's a reason why he's in the Hall of Fame. He was a force.
And his stolen base stealing style was different from yours?
Yeah, it was. He was a glider. He ran on top of the ground. Him, Davey Lopes were the same. They ran on top of the ground. Me and Ricky Henderson were power runners. Okay, we if you went back and looked at where we took off from, there's some deep, a lot of dirt being moved there, but we were accelerating going into the base, second base, and you know, slid hard, and at the beginning of my career, I slid head first because I didn't have my steps down there. Later in my career, it was 13 steps of slide. But Ricky Henderson, first off, he's in my top 10 athletes of all time. And he slid from the time he came into baseball till the time he left. He slid head first. That's a beating. That's a beating on your body. And for him to do that, and he could steal third base from a standstill. That's how explosive he was. Yeah, there's no. Ricky was an awesome force, one of the top five offensive forces to ever play the game.
Mike from Bellingham, Washington. Hi, friends. Watch out for the Seattle Mariners. Everyone talking Oakland A's here. Now you have a guy talking about the present. We're being jerked into the present. Any thoughts on the Seattle Mariners today?
They've got a good young team, and they had a good pitching season. You know, and had some maximum or best year pitching years from some of their pitchers. They got a young staff, but if they get anywhere near the performance on the mound that they had last year, they're going to be a contender. They've got a good young nucleus of ball players. Yeah. And they pick up the ball well.
Okay, back to the 70s great players, Goose Gossage.
You didn't have to run up on him. It was going to get there. He threw real hard. And he was the epitome of a closer. I mean, you never saw his eyes because he'd wear that hat down on his head, but he'd come at you. He was over there before he went to the Yankees. He was in Chicago, him and Terry Forster.
Right.
And they both ended up closing. But those guys, they could fill it up, man. But Gossage was a tremendous presence on the mound. Big guy. And he gave you all arms and legs, and then that ball would pop out of there, and it was moving. He threw 98, 99, you know. Yeah, that wasn't fun.
Didn't you feel kind of sad, though, when the Yankees just cast aside Sparky Lyle, who was a great closer, and then brought in Gossage?
Yeah, Sparky was tough, too. And, you know, but, you know, Sparky had a good career, and they still used him. You know, he could get you out. He had a hump in his fastball. You know, it was going down when it was coming to the plate, but he threw a real heavy ball. You know, and he would hurt to hit sometimes, especially if you got inside on him. You know, he'd bust your hands up, boy.
Okay, another guy from the 70s, Carl Yastrzemski.
Well, come on, man. Yes. We were playing in 75. We were playing the playoffs, and Vida Blue was pitching. And the first time through the lineup, you know, in our scouting report on how to pitch Yastrzemski was never throw him that fastball low and outside because he hit it up on that monster. And Vida, it was one of the most, in the first couple of innings, it was one of the most power control pitching that I've ever seen him do. But then they got somebody got on base, and he threw him a nasty fastball. Low and outside, he stripped to hit it up on that wall, hit it over that wall. But we could have won that series because we hit the ball harder, But what when Nestrinski was in left field, he would a ball hit on the line that would be a home run in a lot of parks, a line drive. He turned a ball that would have been a home run in another park into singles because he played that wall well.
Right.
And you know, and now you're taking four bases and making it one. And that was a very, very big part of that series in the 75.
Joey from Bucks County, Pennsylvania. Hey, Bill, give me your top five baseball parks to play in. I know your worst. Welcome to Philadelphia.
I like Philadelphia. I could hit there. But the number one park was, of course, Dodger Stadium. It was the most beautiful one, and it was very well kept. What else do you go to? Baltimore? No, it was, I can't remember too many others because they were all old stadiums, you know. But as far as it goes, I liked San Diego. Atlanta was pretty good. Pittsburgh, I liked that.
Three Rivers?
I mean, I'm just talking about where I feel good, and I hit well. And Montreal, too. Yeah.
How about
Montreal? They never finished.
How about Yankee Stadium?
Well, old Yankee Stadium. Yankee Stadium was a tough place to play, but, of course, you got to throw that in there because of its history. And when you walked into Yankee Stadium for the first time, it was like going to Mecca and paying homage, you know, because of all the history of the ballpark. But they had some tough fans out there in Yankee Stadium, boy. They all looked like they had taken drugs.
Did you ever yearn to be a Yankee?
No, I had an opportunity to be a Yankee, and I didn't want to go there. I wanted to go back to the National League, but
right.
They were trying to work a trade. Reggie wanted me over there.
But okay, go ahead.
It didn't go through, so, you know, and then when I was a free agent, they also approached me, you know, but, hey.
And you signed with the Giants.
Yeah.
In your time with the Giants, you must have met Willie Mays.
Come on, man. I played against Willie Mays.
Beat a dead horse here, but let me ask you two questions. One, did you ever ask Willie Mays about Leo Durocher, and did Durocher ever talk about Willie Mays?
Yeah, Durocher would talk about him, but Durocher wasn't my favorite. You know, you kind of, when you were around those guys, Hank Aaron and McCovey and stuff, and you were young, you know, because we would be in spring training and that, and we'd be at the same restaurant and something like that. I was surprised when Willie Mays came up to me and he said, hey, no, he always called me North. And he said hi to me because I didn't want to disturb him. These guys were icons, and I was just this little punk coming to the game. But it was nice to be recognized by him. And then as it went on, we had more interactions and stuff. And then being with the Giants and he'd come to the ballpark and stuff. And he was a good man. He was a proud man. And I saw him one day when I was with the Cubs where he had some rest. And he had a day. He went 3 for 3, and he ran the bases like he was young. And I said, if that's the way he played all of the time, because I saw him when he was on his last legs. And if that's the way he played all the time, he might have been the greatest ball player. You know, that one day he was. You know,
nice. But you never talked about Leo DeRocher with Willie Mays.
No.
Okay. I'm sorry I keep bringing that up. Another guy from the 70s, Louis Tiant.
King Louis. You know, he had all of those motions and stuff like that. But if you did get to first base, he was very difficult to run on because he was so quick. And you know, he had that kick and everything, but he varied his time. Him like Gaylord Perry, you know, they made you play base-to-base baseball. And it wasn't like you were out there just running on him. So Marichal was that way, too.
Did you run on Tiant?
No.
Never?
Unless I had to. Yeah, I ran on him sometimes. But you like to be able to, when you're at first base as a base stealer, you like to be able to control that situation. You know, and make the pitcher make adjustments. But some of them, like Tiant, they controlled the situation, and they knew how to kind of keep you off balance because of some little things that they used to do. He used to balk to first base on that move because he dipped that left knee towards third base and then swing over there. And you, everything is supposed to be coming to first base. You can't have any motion towards home plate or anything. But some guys would dip that front knee and then come over there. And that's how they got quick. But Tiant, Perry, Marichal, Steve Carlton had a good move too. A bunch of them, yeah. Steve Busby, yeah.
Yeah, you guys had, the ALCS 75, you guys were part of that. Of course, 75 World Series was a cool World Series, and you were a part of it by being in the ALCS. Another guy from the 70s, Daryl Porter. Any memories of Daryl Porter?
Daryl Porter was a good hitter. He was up there in Milwaukee for a while, and Kansas City, and yeah, he was a good player. He'd go out there every day too, and he handled that pitching staff in Kansas City. But yeah, he was a good player. That's a blast from the past, you know.
Well, they're all blasts from more than 50 years ago. Another guy from the 70s, Dave Giusti, G-U-I-S-T-I,
yeah.
Giusti. Is that how you say it?
Yeah, Dave Giusti. He pitched for Pittsburgh, and he when I first came up in 72, and I hadn't been playing, and I struck out 17 out of my first 29 times up because I was just too anxious, and he would throw me a fastball inside, and then he'd mix in that a palm ball, that changeup, and I'd swing. I'd be so excited to want to get out early on the fastball if it's inside, and he'd throw me a changeup. I could have swung three times before it got to the plate. And that's how they worked me when I first came up, you know, because I didn't play at the beginning of the season, even though I should have, because I won the job in the spring. That was the year of the strike in 72. And then they spotted me in and out, and I never got a rhythm. And 72 was a tough year for me.
Our guest has been Mr. Bill North, who played Major League Baseball from 1971 to 1981. He was the starting center fielder and leadoff hitter for the coolest MLB team of all time, the Oakland A's from the early 1970s. The time has flown. The time is gone, Bill. Time flies when you're having fun, and this is always a lot of fun. Do you have any final words tonight for our audience, Mr. Bill North?
Yeah, I just want you guys to remember Sal Bando and that. He was my teammate, and he was a friend, and he's a hell of a man, and God rest his soul.
And God bless Sal Bando. He's from the Cleveland area.
Yeah, he is. Right.
Solon, Ohio.
Was it Akron?
Solon.
Is that right outside of Cleveland?
Yeah, it's a Cleveland suburb, yeah.
Yeah. He was one of those Ohio boys. Ray Fosse was Ohio. Wasn't Thurman Munson?
Yeah, that's why Cleveland ended up signing Chris Bando, because we thought, oh, hell, we missed on a local guy. Bando is starring with the A's and winning three World Series.
Chris went to Arizona State, too, didn't he? Yeah.
Could be.
His daddy did.
Well, we got to go. Let's see. Next week we have Matthew DiBiase again, the author, a wonderful book on NFL coaches. We're going to talk about Bill Walsh, John Madden, the San Francisco 49ers of the 1980s, John Madden, and the
my favorite, the
Oakland Raiders in the 70s. Wow. So, and then we'll have Bill North again in 2 weeks, and we'll continue. What a gift! What a gift to have you on the show every 2 weeks, Bill.
I consider it a gift. Thank you for having me. We have fun.
We have a good time, and I'm so excited about your show. I love all the guys you've had on, and I'm looking forward to Herb Washington and whoever you bring on, Dusty Baker or any. You're talking Davey Lopes, Bobby Grich, and we'll see who you come up with.
All righty.
Very good. Dear listener.
Thank you, Peter.
Oh, thank you, Bill. What a gift. What a wonderful, wonderful gift. Dear listener, may the road rise to meet you. May the wind be at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face and rains fall soft upon your fields. And until we meet again, may God hold you in the palm of his hand. Good night, everybody. Thank you so much again, Mr. Bill North.